Again, only the second time at this new venue, and it seems even better this time. We're really grateful to the Paper Museum for letting us be here. Michael, what are you doing?
I'm writing a column and a website. I'm going to put your picture in there.
But you could do that some other time. This is a reading we called the McEver reading after Bruce McEver, who endowed one of the two chairs in poetry here at Georgia Tech. My name is Thomas Lux, and I have the great privilege of being a born professor of poetry here at Georgia Tech. This is also, as I said, the McEver, what we call the McEver reading, but we try to bring as many Georgia poets as we can here, and poets at Georgia Tech, too. As people are surprised, but there's quite a few of us oddballs at Georgia Tech. The poets are going to read alphabetically. I'm just going to hold up one of their books. Their books are for sale afterwards, but Rosemary Daniel is going to read first. A Sexual Tour of the Deep South is one of her books. Rosemary Daniel, please welcome her.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I'd like to read a little three-line story of my life. It's something that I ask people to do in my writing groups, Zona Rosa. And many of them have done it to good effect. And in doing this exercise, people can put any slant on their lives that they would like. I was born to crazy parents. The wild high school dropout, an older sister who broke all the rules, took all the risks, and by all rights should have paid the price. But instead, my life was blessed, and despite that I married the wrong man four times, and two of my adult children were afflicted with mental illnesses, I was able to become a writer and teacher, to travel to beautiful places, and to meet many wonderful people from all over the world, just as I had dreamed I would at 20. And my books about my experiences have helped many of them. So that's my own little introduction of myself. One of the primary subjects of my early poetry is sexual politics, and I would like to start with a two-sentence poem, a new poem that I came across in preparing for this reading, and the title of it is The Nature of Men, The Nature of Women. The man begins throwing, breaking things. The woman picks up the glass, so he won't cut his feet. And then this poem from Fort Bragg, Another Point South, my second book of poetry. I worked for 12 years in poetry in the schools, and this meant going all over the place. And I did this in Wyoming, South Carolina, and Georgia. And one of the places where I spent a lot of time was Milledgeville, Georgia. And I taught poetry workshops both in the women's prison and in the schools, the school systems for the Poetry in the Schools program. And I stayed in the John Milledge Motel is still there. It was cinder block. It was, you can imagine what it was like, because it was $25 a week for a room, $25 a week. And Flannery O'Connor's house was across the street. And it was said that Jane Mansfield had actually stayed in this same motel. And this is a poem about my time there. I began this poem before my mother's suicide, and I learned of her overdose and that she was dying while I was in Milledgeville. I got the call from my sister Anne saying that she had taken an overdose and she was being taken to the hospital, Crawford Long in Atlanta. So I completed the poem many years afterward, after her death. Oh, Jane Mansfield, Flannery O'Connor, my mother and me. And the poem is for Alice Walker, whose blackness made the enemy visible. Myth of the Spanish moss, Within each hard tree, a bound woman rise, her hair twists of ash, claws crawls the air. In Milledgeville, live oaks blanch the blood of the lambs, Debs in white cotton panties, crimped matrons in slips of white lace, all the permanent daughters of the Confederacy caught in their corsets of white brocade. Yes, this is an ash blonde town, the white satin undergarment of the white of the Baptist belt, of swamps where white crew cut sheriffs run down blacks and women. It's 3 a.m. and I lie in the John Millage Motel, room 4D, where Jane Mansfield slept, a half mile down Highway 441 from the white townhouse where Flannery stitched the white home ec apron required for her graduation from the same school where my mother wore white midi blouses, wrote on white notebook paper, "I want to marry a lawyer, live in a house with white columns." And trying not to hear through white walls the sounds of white male cursing, I think Jane, her white satin hair spreading, her white plastic breasts rising beneath this cover of white chenille, the white sperm of half of America gliding across her light pancake cheeks, and imagine Flannery, sweet between her white girl's sheets, watching upon a white ceiling, blank white pages, the petty four with white icing of literary teas. And now flash my mother, her pons palms pressed against her magnolia petal face, dreaming the blonde man who would save her, the white roses, the white satin wedding, the honeymoon trip. Yet listening to the motherfuckers, sons of bitches, the brute motel plans made by white southern men, I wonder, did Jane see already her decapitation on a dark road outside New Orleans, her head, that clairol pale egg, severed as in life from her body? Or did Flannery, Catholic and weird, feel even then the wolf disease eating out her teenage limbs, the falling hair, melting hip bones, the hospital cuff, tightening? And did my mother, even before my Cherokee-tinged father, the drinking and the gambling, the bills and torn underwear, sob into her dormitory pillow, bubbling within her bell's brain pan with the lobotomies of marriage, the electrodes for shock, her suicide at 60? Yes, did each of them, Jane, her throat neatly stitched, Flannery, her face turned moony by cortisone, my mother whitened to wax by Revlon, her upper lip bleached blonde, wearing her best white gold costume jewelry. Yes, did each of them know, lying in this white satin-lined sarcophagus for women, that the first drop of blood ruins the crotches of white cotton panties, spots the slips of white nylon lace, stains the backs of white wedding dresses, yes, turns each of us scarlet women, deserving of mutilation, disease, damnation, that we, like the women in the trees, are embalmed, and recalling my rage, washing between pale blue lines, the blood-black scrawl of my mother's girlish plans, I wonder what sleep awaits me, freak of cunt and brain, in this place, pure, white, chaste, that murders women. Thank you. I moved to Savannah, Georgia from Atlanta after my third divorce, and I embarked on a different way of life, a very much more bohemian way of life. It was loads of fun, and I had a lot of, you know, there was a lot of freedom and fun in this life, and yet finally it came to its natural conclusion. And this is for my friend John Paul, who is also deceased. This is titled Grief for the Drunken Good Times. Remember the time I called my ex from the bar and fell down on the cobblestones, and later near dawn met a shoe salesman from Charleston, slept with him in my room while you, his straight pal, lay fully clothed atop the covers on Miss Jane's bed? And how the next day we laughed through hangovers at the way afloat on white Chanel, he kept shiny black Oxfords on, tall sentinels against your mouth. And the time when stoned on kamikazes, I necked in front of the crowd with an 18-year-old, danced on the stage with a drag queen, holding up my dress mons level, pirouetted without my panties on. And do you recall when the waitress wouldn't bring our check and we left anyway, and I wet my pants on River Street and we all went to Dr. Feelgood's, where my male lover danced with my female lover, Miss Jane, and she got mad, burst the tires on my Fiat, left angry for the movie set? And how before long, in a house full of orchids, the scent of sensimilia, with the cake with cabbage roses, she became your bride, and we all jumped into a pool with or without wedding clothes on, and you, your pregnant wife, and I made love in a bright white room. Oh, I know they say that people who drink are miserable, but I don't remember it that way. We were more like lovely fish, silver-finned in our element. But all that was before the baby son you never saw again, the man who retaught me pain, before the booze dug fingers deep inside our brains, clawing out chunks, getting to the quick, before sex turned to rage, good times to grief. And now, as chaste as a Jane Austen heroine, I read novels, drink tea in bed, and at times from my window watch you walk home from the grocery, an aging man with your one bag, and I wonder if you feel as I do. Oh God, I pray never to be that way again. Oh God, I want those old days back. I'd like to read a couple of poems from a new manuscript. It's called The Murderous Sky, Poems of Madness and Mercy. And in this book, I direct my attention more outward and to painful experiences that both I and others have had. And there's a epigraph from Pat Barker from her novel Ghost Road about the poet. The novel is about the poet Wilfred Owen in World War II. First-person narrators can't die. So long as we keep telling the story of our lives, we're safe. Ha, bloody fucking ha. In this book, a number of the poems are written about people that I was introduced to through media. And this particular poem came to me as an idea when I saw a young man interviewed on Oprah, and this is about what had actually happened to him. He and his sister were at a 7-Eleven, and he went inside, and the car it was a sports car, burst into flames with his sister inside, and the police, no one could open the door, and she burned to death. And this the interview was about how this had affected his life. And the epigraph of the poem is, I love them as poets love the poetry that kills them, as drowned sailors love the sea. Derek Walcott, The Power of Love. The boy is clawing a burning sister from the burning sports car, a triumph, I think. She's stuck and he's shouting, I love you, and she's shouting it back, and they're both screaming. But the power of love can't save her. He socks the cop who drags him away. And for the rest of his life, he lives with that guilt. As a young man lying on beaches in strange beds, as a father looking into the face of his baby daughter, at 30 slurring to the barkeep, another double, pouring into his flesh what he dreams will put out memory. Oh, stop blubbering, the woman with him souls, not caring about how he failed, how if he had been a real man, and doesn't he know people don't want to hear about that? Still on his deathbed at 50, the slime of cancer filling his lungs, his last vision as drowning, he goes under, is his sister going up in flames, and what he hears are her screams, "I love you, I love you." And they're both crying and screaming of how the power of love can't save her, of how the power of love can't save him. This is what the boy hears on his deathbed. "And I think how the power of my love can't save you or anyone, of how no matter how hard I tug, I can't pull you from the blaze of madness, of drugs, of disease. And how, like that boy, his sister, you too will reach out your arms. You too will pull me close to the flames, screaming, I love you, I love you. How I too will die hearing your cries." And the last long poem is from the same book, and this is about my daughter, Lily, as I always call her in my writing, who is a survivor of 20 years of heroin addiction. And this is during a period of the time when she was an active addict. "Sacred things are not the ancient Chinese tapestry, silk heavy with embroidery stitched 1,000 years ago, that stone you cut up to make an ugly dress. Are the few pieces of sterling, each stamped with a rose, left from a wedding before you were born? Nor was it that heavy gold snake, my one good piece of jewelry, coiled in its box, waiting to be pawned again. And of course, not that small plastic card embossed with the magic numbers with which you carved the money from my account as easily as you would butter with a knife. Or are they the nights and nights spent writhing? For though I, with my sins, am an unlikely one, turn good only through default, we know that all mothers are saints, eager to give up their own lives. No, none of these are the sacred things that stand like totems, like the cast Egyptian cat you loved beside the door to pain as it heaves, clangs open again. Nor are these the objects that lay as though carelessly thrown onto the stone slab, that ancient, it seems rock for sacrifice, like my heart gone bloodstained and bloodstained, born as we were with a black bowel running in our family, a river, or was it more like a swamp or quicksand? No. What is the snapshot of you at 3 in your red velvet bowler, the ribbons bouncing down your plump back in your black princess coat with white fur collar, your fat legs churning the petals of your tripe. Next, your dimpled arms around my knees as you beg for red jam on white bread. Yes, that and the drawing you made at 8. Your pitiful pearl doll, the tears rolling down her plastic cheeks, the balloon over her head reading, Mother, please love me, or the sketch of me at my desk typing. I dreamed the house was on fire and you wouldn't save me, reads the caption. And then, captured by your girlish hand, the watercolor of the 100-foot pines, the goldfish pond carved of coral rock, our calico perched beside it, watching the swerve of red fish. Or later, the memory of you striding up Fifth Avenue in high heels and short fur, gorgeous in your Italian boy haircut, more confident, it seemed, than I had ever been. And the picture taken by the famous artist, the one who was once my lover, you, newly blonde, a tumble of gold and cream, trussed in red velvet for your gig at the Gaslight Club. A woman from another century who will soon learn the things I, her mother, will never know about needles in shooting galleries, about bombed out buildings with men standing overhead holding guns, about where one buys the works neatly cellophaned, and finally about overdoses, hospitals, and jail cells. And that was when? 10 years, an eternity ago. Before I watched what had been my vision of you, my beautiful one, stepping off that greyhound, eyes purple by a fist, an old man's shirt hiding the knife cuts, the blood-black gashes marking your perfect flesh, and all your things, your poor things, stuffed into that one green plastic garbage bag. But the most sacred may be the photo of you taken 5 years ago when your long hair, a radiant shawl to your heart-shaped face, the scars inside your elbows like mauve pencil dots, hidden by the merry blue cotton gown, your deep-lashed eyes shining with stars, or is it tears, into the eyes of your newborn? Raphael, angel, you called him, and scrawled on the back is the fat, arid heart, tears dripping from its jagged tear, and inside it the names of Jamie and Bob, the happy couple, who the next day in a lawyer's stayed rooms will take him from our arms forever. Oh my God, cried out the man I once read of, drawn and quartered, yet still holding in his hands his own beating heart. And yet, yes, these are the sacred things, the muscle ripped from the living breast, the wounds made by blades, rough-edged and blunt, the kinds of sacrifices after which none ever matter again. And I'd like to conclude with this six-line poem. There are two epigraphs. One is by Rebecca West. Before Wordsworth, daffodils were called weeds. And Louise Bogan, I cannot believe that the inscrutable universe turns on an axis of suffering. Surely the strange beauty of the world must somehow rest on pure joy. April in Massachusetts. A few yellow buds and two full-blown purple crocuses with butter centers, right where the ice was last week, after years of too many azaleas, frantic blood flush. This suddenly is enough. Thank you.